Welcome to the video lecture series on sociology. Today we'll be discussing social institutions from the chapter 3 of class 11 textbook. In this lecture, we'll be talking about social institutions. We'll be discussing social institution from the functionalist perspective and also from the conflict theory perspective. And then we'll talk about the family, which is the universal social institution. Now, let's come on to social institution. If we have to recap what we have learnt till now, we have studied that the sociology talks about interaction of individual and society. And we know that each of us as individuals occupies a place or location in society. And each one of us has roles, and it could be the multiple roles, but these are not simply what we as individuals choose. You know, there are a number of factors which defines what role we'll play in a society. And there are social institutions that constrain, control, punish, and rewards. And if we talk about these social institutions, there could be the macro social institutions, as in state, and there could be a micro social institutions like family. Now, let's try to understand what these social institutions are. When we talk about institution, it is something that works according to rules established or at least acknowledged by law or a custom. And the regular and continuous operation of such institutions cannot be understood without taking those rules into account, which means that when we talk about institutions, these rules, these customs are very important, and these are there so that the society and the institutions, they run very smoothly. Now, these institutions, they impose constraints and they also provide opportunities to the members of society. Till now, we have actually discussed that, you know, in a sociology, there are conflicting views, there are diverse views, and we have looked at various concepts, and we have looked at those concepts from the functionalist viewpoint and from the conflict theory viewpoint. Now, let us try to understand this social institution also from the functionalist perspective and also from the conflict theory perspective. Functionalist perspective view understands social institution as a complex set of social norms, values, beliefs, and role relationships that arise in response to the needs of a society, which means that, you know, these norms, these values, these beliefs are necessary for any society so that it runs smoothly. And these social institutions exist to satisfy those social needs. And when we talk about, you know, these institutions, there could be the formal institution and there could be the informal institution. If we have to take an example of formal social institution, the education could be the formal social institution, and the family and the religion could be the informal social institution. Now, if we look at a social institution from the conflict viewpoint, so the conflict view holds that all individuals are not placed equally in society. This we have already discussed in our previous lectures, that there is one dominant class, and that dominant class actually exerts pressure on the other people. Now, all social institutions, whether the familial, religious, political, economic, legal, or educational, will operate in the interest of the dominant section of the society, and it could be class, caste, tribe, or gender. Now, this dominant social section, they not only dominate the political or the economic institution, but the most important thing is that they ensure that the ruling class ideas become the ruling ideas of the society. Now, this is the difference between, you know, the social institution, if we look at, you know, social institution from the functionalist perspective, and when we look at the social institution from the conflict perspective. Now, if we look at these social institutions, there are number of social institutions, and in your chapter, you know, these social institutions are actually categorized into the broad areas. We'll be talking about the family, marriage, and kinship. Then there is a, you know, social institutions in the economic field, political field, education, and religion. So, in this lecture, we'll be focusing more on family, marriage, and kinship. But before that, let us understand, you know, what family, marriage, and kinship, these, you know, the different terms means. Family is a group of a person directly linked by kin connections. the adult member of which assumes responsibility for caring for children. And when we talk about kinship, kinship ties are connection between individuals established either through marriage or through lines of descent that connects blood relatives. Now, marriage can be defined as a socially acknowledged and approved sexual union between the two individuals. When two people marry, they become kin to one another. The marriage bond also, however, connects together a wide range of people. And if a person is born in a family, that family is called family of orientation. And if it is married into a one particular family, then it becomes a family of procreation. And if, you know, one is related to someone through blood, that is called the consanguineal relationship. And if, you know, someone are related through marriage, those relationships are called affine relationships. Now, let's talk about family in detail. When we talk about family, no social entity appears more natural than the family. Right, and often we are prone to assume that the family are like the one we live in across the world. But when we talk about the sociology and social anthropology, I mean, the sociologists and anthropologists, they have conducted research and they have shown that how important the institution of marriage and how different, you know, are they in their character in the different societies and in different culture. And they have also studied and they have also showed the relationship between and the link between the private sphere and the public sphere. Private sphere as in family and its relationship to the public sphere as in like to the economic situation, political situation, religious situation and the education of that particular society. Now, let us look at family from the functionalist perspective. The family perform important tasks which contribute to society's basic needs and help perpetuate social order. And the functionalist perspective argue that the modern industrial societies function best if the families are nuclear families, which says that the man plays a very instrumental role. He goes out and earn for the family, wherein the woman has a very effective and emotional role, and that too in the domestic setting. But if we look at this thing, I mean, it is questionable because one, it is gender unjust. And second, if we look at the India and if we look at, you know, the, you know, economy in India post, you know, liberalization or industrialization, we still have, you know, a lot of joint families. And it's not like that the nuclear family is only solution for, you know, such arrangements. And here I would like to quote, you know, what a noted sociologist, Mr. A.M. Shah, said, and it is also there in your textbook. The sociologist A.M. Shah remarks that in post-independent India, the joint family has steadily increased. The contributing factor is the increasing life expectancy in India, according to him. It has increased from 32.5 to 55.4 years for men, and from 31.7 to 55.7 years for women during the period 1941 to 50 and to 1981 to 85. Consequently, the proportion of aged people in total population has increased. And Mr. Shah asked a question, and he asked that we have to ask, in what kind of household do these elderly people live? I submit, most of them live in joint household. Now, this is also a very broad generalization, but then this also cautions us against, you know, believing the commonsensical approach and, you know, the debate which is going on in the society that the joint families are eroding. And it also says that whatever we see in a society and whatever we feel that, you know, it's a common sense and the commonsensical approach, we have to question that, and you know, we have to come out with the things after comparative and the empirical research. So this is what, you know, the family is all about, and the functionalist perspective on family is all about. Now let's have a look at the family norms. And when we talk about the family norms, there are diverse family norms, and the families are divided on the basis of, you know, the two major, you know, concepts or issues. One is that, you know, according to the rule of residence, and according to that, you know, there are the matrilocal families and the patrilocal families in the marriage and family custom. Now, the matrilocal family is the family wherein, you know, after the marriage, spouse lives with the woman's parents. And the patrilocal marriages and the institutions are the one in which the spouse, they live, you know, with the men's parents. And another way of classifying is according to the authority and dominance exercised. One is the patriarchal family and another is the matriarchal family. In the patriarchal family, the authority and the dominance is exercised by men. And in the matriarchal family, you know, the women, they play a very major role in taking, you know, the major decisions in a family. Now, let us discuss marriage as a social institution. When we talk about marriage as a social institution, I mean, it can also be classified into, you know, the different categories, and it could be classified on the basis of the number of partners one can have in the matrimony and the rules governing who can marry whom. Now, when we talk about, you know, the number of partners one can have in a matrimony or in a marriage, there can be the two groups. One is the monogamy, which restricts individual to one spouse at a time. And another one is polygamy. Polygamy is like one can have one or two or more than two partners in the marriage. Now, even in the polygamy, there are two classification. One is polygyny. Polygyny is one husband with two or more wives, and polyandry, one wife with two or more husbands. Now, there's another concept which is called serial monogamy. Now, the serial monogamy is, you know, after the death of one particular partner and maybe after the divorce, one can again get into the matrimony, one can again, you know, marry, you know, another person. So, this is what the serial monogamy is all about. Now, let us discuss about, you know, the rules and the prescription when it comes to marriages. And on the basis of that also, there are two main categories. One is endogamy, that requires an individual to marry within a culturally defined group of which he or she is already a member. And the second one is the exogamy, which is totally reverse of endogamy, which requires individual to marry outside his or her group. Now, endogamy and exogamy are in reference to certain kinship units such as clan, caste, racial, ethnic or social groupings. And when we talk about India, and if we take an example of Indian village, you know, exogamy is practiced in certain parts of North India. And this is done, and this arrangement actually ensures the smooth transition and adjustment of bride into the final home without interference of kinsmen. And this is done, and that is how, you know, when we look at the marriages, and there are number of, you know, the sad songs, you know, when a girl is going away from the family. So this is all about, you know, the family as an institution. And today we talked about family, we talked about marriage, we talked about kinship, and we talked about, you know, the family from the functionalist and the conflict theory perspective, and we also talked about social institution from the functionalist and the conflict theory perspective. Now, there are certain activities which you can get involved in to understand this concept in a better way. Now, what you can do is, we've just discussed about, you know, exogamy. Can you collect certain, you know, wedding songs and discuss how they reflect social dynamics of marriages and of gender relations? You know, whenever you go to a wedding, you listen so many songs. At times, you know, you are not interested to listen to these songs, but you, if you listen to these songs carefully, you would know that, you know, this actually reflects the dynamics of marriage and of the gender relations. So you can, you know, observe those particular songs, and you listen to those particular songs carefully and discuss with your friends and with your peers about that. Now, there's another activity which you can get involved in is analyze matrimonial advertisements from the different newspapers and try to find out that, you know, whether this endogamy is still the norm in our society. And after you have analyzed these advertisements, you can share your observation with your friends, with your peer group, and you can also share your observation with us. We have created a Google group, and by now I think you all are aware of that particular group wherein you can share your observations. So that is all for now. Thank you very much.